graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents The Kertherian Gambit, Book 2, Queen Bitch, by Michael Anderle. Narrated by Colleen Delany and performed by a full cast. Brașov, Romania.
Well, there we could definitely find the higher-end clothes and makeup, but I'm not sure about the shoes.
Then we keep looking.
Bethany Anne waited for Ekaterina and Nathan to give her the most important information she needed to focus on for the next day. Where could she go shopping? In the last 8 months, she had expected to die, was introduced to a vampire, eventually resulting in genetic changes to her body, and was compelled to eat people. Granted, for the bulk of that time, she'd been asleep while her alien symbiont was making said changes. Even so, the past few weeks alone had been pretty damn disturbing. Now, Bethany Anne and the core of her newly formed team spent some time regrouping in their Romanian basement hideaway, and she was seriously in need of some shopping therapy. Most particularly, a fabulous pair of shoes. She no longer needed the stiletto heels short girl workaround anymore. The symbiont's changes to her body included making her legs 6 inches longer. What she did need was to feel like a woman for a while. Her abilities notwithstanding, she was accustomed to projecting confidence behind the armor of a Coach purse, a pair of Louboutins, and a tailored suit, none of which should have bloodstains on them, something she couldn't say about most of the clothes she had worn for the past few days.
Excuse me, may I?
Of course.
For such a sharp-witted woman in other aspects of her life, Ekaterina sure did let her insecurities blind her to Nathan's clear interest in her.
Ugh.
But with Michael both absent and silent, Bethany Anne had bigger fish to fry. She hoped and prayed that Michael was busy trying to find out more about a serum that helped create intelligent Nosferatu. If the Forsaken, the splinter group of Michael's family that believed humans should be a subjugated race, truly had a workable serum, they could potentially create cannon fodder numbering in the billions for their army. There were two items near the top of Bethany Anne's to-do list. Getting back in contact with Bill's government liaison to see which, if any, operations needed her skills, and having a talk with Stephen. Stephen was one of Michael's immediate children and lived on the other side of the Carpathian Mountains. He was the parent of Petra, whom she had killed. Nathan had wanted her to get permission before she took Petra out, but she decided introducing herself to the unknown world in stricture-bending fashion was required to get the respect necessary to move forward with an agenda even Michael didn't know needed to occur. An agenda that included getting the world prepared for a possible intergalactic war in the not-so-distant future. But at the tippy-top of her to-dos was to see about those shoes.
Well, this is Frank.
Frank Kearns, the United States government liaison to the unknown world, was in his office below ground in one of D.C.'s older government buildings. It worked out well, both for him and for those he might have to meet who wanted to remain anonymous or out of the sun. There were two old tunnels he could access from his level. One of them was left over from World War II, and the other he had built in the 70s. That one didn't show up on any plans for the building, historical or current.
Good evening, Frank. It's Jerry.
Jerry was not only the head of the American PAC Council and the alpha of the New York PAC, he was also Nathan's direct alpha.
Oh, good evening, Jerry. How can I help you?
Since Frank had asked a favor of Nathan, Jerry's second, a week and a half ago, he'd expected to hear from Jerry when Nathan failed to contact him.
I've got an update, if you can make heads or tails of it. And a concern.
Oh, let's hear both.
First, the update. Doesn't make a lot of sense to me, but my second sent me an email via a third party that I'm not familiar with. Says to let you know the lady was found. She was fully grown and no dad in sight. I'm going out on a limb here and assuming this has to do with Michael?
Yes, it does. I suspect the fully grown part means the woman is a vampire now. That isn't necessarily going to sit well with the general, but the alternative would be to conclude that his daughter was dead. I'll have to find a way to make sure he at least knows she didn't die. Although I do wonder why your second didn't pass this on to me himself.
Frank, you know Nathan. He's going to be pretty circumspect about anything he does around a vampire, even a young one who might not be all that strong. And besides, I'm not so sure she is weak. He must be with the vampire if he didn't call you directly. I imagine she doesn't want to talk to you yet.
Then why did he get hold of you? And why isn't he concerned about updating you?
Well, I suspect she didn't absolutely forbid communicating with me. He has a responsibility to try to keep me in the loop, and, through me, you. Why she isn't communicating with you would be my question. Do you know much about this new vamp?
Right now, Frank needed any backing he could get. Since Bill's murder, he'd lost 22 men in 17 raids, all of them black ops, because he no longer had access to one of Michael's family for assistance. Since Michael and Carl had disappeared, he had no way to contact and coerce any of Michael's family to help. Michael ran the family in North America. There were some vampires in South America, but that was a forsaken zone, and Frank never connected with them, with good reason.
Her name is Bethany Anne Reynolds, and she is, or was, an operative in a semi-black agency based here in Washington, D.C. I'm not sure I have all the particulars on how long it takes to convert someone to a vampire, but I didn't think it took more than a week, maybe two, certainly not longer than a month, and she's been missing for over 7 months. What did you mean earlier about not being so sure she's weak? I thought Michael took care of her conversion. That should just about guarantee she's pretty strong.
Well, that would make sense. Rumor has it, the Brishov Pact in Romania, where Nathan went, has suffered several highly placed members' deaths. Nathan didn't say he was in the hospital, and why I wouldn't want to take Nathan on, I feel pretty confident he didn't single-handedly take out 7 wares who are rumored to be dead right now. Oh, and one vampire.
What?
Given the right situation, Nathan Lowell could certainly have taken out 7 pack members, as long as he didn't have to fight them all at once. But for one thing, his task hadn't been to get involved, merely to locate and report his findings. And for another, Frank couldn't imagine what could happen that might cause Nathan to get involved beyond Frank's find and report request. It wasn't like he had a personal interest in anyone involved.
Yeah, European Council has been hearing about some shady connections between the Brishov Pact Alpha Algerian and Petre, one of Steven's kids. Now, the Council's been contacted by the Brishov Pact via someone about midway down the hierarchy. This person went out to Petre's house for some information, only to find his house has been trashed in a fire and had 2 burnt bodies inside. One of them had an arm and, get this, a head missing. They found the burnt skull on the other side of the room. These 2 bodies were the wehr officers who hung with Petre for daytime protection. They were able to locate Petre's exits and found one that opened up about 200 yards away. There was a bloody bear trap sprung by the hole. They could still smell a little of Petre's blood on the trap, but no Petre.
Frank's mind tried to furiously work out the ramifications of everything Jerry told him. He needed more information.
Damn, Jerry. Now that you've given me more than a headache, I'm afraid to ask. What concerns are you calling me with?
Yeah, it's the young and dumb. They haven't seen a really scary vampire in years, and now they're starting to act up. The Council can put a lid on it for just so long before either a vampire needs to take care of it, or the Council will have to decide which way they really want to go with this not-telling-the-world stricture. When we had Michael to lay the blame on, it was easy to claim it just wasn't in our power to deal with. Now Michael's gone missing. Or at least, that's the rumor.
Yes, Michael is missing. As I said, Nathan was supposed to find and report on Michael and Bethany Anne. Apparently he's found Bethany Anne, and God only knows what else he's been up to. So, you guys want what from me, exactly?
I need to get Nathan's input and your thoughts. What do you think will happen if we allow more werewolf sightings to occur?
Both Frank and Jerry well knew that if humans could confirm the existence of the supernatural, all sorts of problems would arise. Frank could think of a few that would be pretty negative, and that didn't even include what the major religions would say.
Yeah, okay. I'll see if I can get in touch with Bethany Anne. I'm not sure what she can do to scare the so-called young and dumb, But she is a vampire and will probably talk to me. The rest of Michael's kids only talk to Carl, and he's missing as well. If it goes completely in the can, I can see about contacting her dad. God, this is a mess.
Yeah. If and when you talk to Nathan, let him know I need him back here in the States. He's got a bit of a reputation for not taking shit from anyone, so maybe he can be the boogeyman for a while.
All right, let me see what assets I have in Romania who might be able to find them. Talk to you later, Jerry.
Take care, Frank.
Frank rubbed his face in frustration. Not only did he need help with the mayhem and destruction, but now the Wares were getting involved and causing friction. This whole pot would explode if someone didn't put a lid back on it, and quickly. Zurich, Switzerland. Bethany Anne felt pretty good. She'd found not one, but two sets of clothes to mix and match in Brasov. In Zurich, she was able to pick up an additional two outfits and another pair of shoes. The train ride over there hadn't been too bad either. She was still taking in etheric energy, and Tom said she could probably pull off two translocations before needing to hit the vein, as he called it. She had stayed in her sleeper compartment for the duration of the trip, resting up, and he had let Nathan know he'd need to rouse her if he felt they were in danger. Ekaterina had stayed behind in Brasov to take care of a few things. They'd meet up in a couple of days, before Bethany Anne went to wake Stephen up, assuming no one else woke him and told him about Petra's demise. While shopping in Brasov, Nathan recognized the perfume and then the face of a woman who'd tracked him and bugged his clothes when he'd first gotten to Brasov. She was pretty hesitant when he approached her. Bethany Anne kept half an eye on the situation when she tried on one of three pairs of shoes she liked. Nathan and the woman stepped out into the courtyard to talk. Bethany Anne noticed Nathan looking around discreetly to see who else could be watching them. Bethany Anne decided to pay for the pair that best suited and asked the clerk to hold them. Fortunately, the clerk's English was good enough to understand. Alexei, Ekaterina's werebear uncle, was visiting family before going home to live on his mountain. Bethany Anne knew where to find him should she need him, and besides, Alexei wasn't one who enjoyed company. Ekaterina had decided to come with Bethany Anne to the States, as expected. She was currently with her brother Ivan, getting some business taken care of, and setting up the discussion to tell their parents she was leaving, or rather, leaving with a man who was unmarried and a woman they didn't know. She wasn't concerned about her dad, but she said her mom would have, how you say, a bunch of cows? The pretty woman Nathan had been talking to left. Bethany Anne raised an eyebrow and looked inquisitively at Nathan as they followed her from the store.
Local pack representative. They've tracked their problems back to me and forces unknown. They didn't agree with how Algerian was getting them involved with Petra, and now that everyone who was pro-vampire is dead, they wanted to make sure I wasn't gunning for them. One problem taken care of.
Bethany Anne watched the woman walk across the courtyard. Just before she got to the other side, about 30 yards away, two men joined her, and they all walked around the corner.
How can we be sure they're telling the truth?
Nathan glanced over to where Bethany Anne was looking.
Pack politics. She says it wasn't just the Brasov pack that wanted the situation stopped, but that the pack contacted the EPC and got a directive from the council. Without Algerian here, they don't have any way to argue the ruling, should they want to. I can't call Jerry in the States and ask him to confirm the ruling.
Bethany Anne looked back at Nathan.
You can't call?
No. Well, I could, but it would be breaking a few rules of decorum around here. If someone from Europe did the same thing in America, it wouldn't raise too many eyebrows. Here in Europe, they'd get their boxers in a twist if I did it.
Is that so?
Nathan was by now accustomed to Bethany Anne's careless disregard for proper channels of communication. He wouldn't be too surprised if she decided to make the call herself, and he resigned himself to whatever she wanted to do. It wasn't as if he'd be able to change her mind anyway. Bethany Anne and Nathan, clad, respectively, in fashionable dark gray suit and a casual sports coat over jeans, entered the Swiss bank. It was a monument to the use of stone as a building material. The beautiful entryway towered over 40 feet over the stone floor that had to have been in place for centuries. Two security guards flanked the entrance into the main banking area. A row of tellers lined the left side. A group of cubicle offices were on the right, and four couches had been placed in a square on a carpet in the middle as a waiting area. A receptionist sat at a desk in front of the waiting area. Large televisions in all the corners were tuned to finance stations. Only one showed CNN. The two of them approached the receptionist.
Good morning.
Welcome, sir. How can we serve your needs today?
Excuse me?
The receptionist quickly looked at Bethany Anne, blushing faintly.
Yes, madame. How can we help you?
I've had accounts opened for me, and I require access to those accounts, along with an explanation of their details. Who can help me?
You would need to speak to Mr. Berger. Unfortunately, he's on the phone at the moment. May I get your name and let him know you are waiting?
My name is Bethany Anne. Please let him know I am not terribly patient.
The receptionist took her information coolly and picked up her phone. Bethany Anne and Nathan went around the desk to sit on a couch.
Why didn't you give your last name? Will he be able to find you?
Oh, yes. This bank does business with vampires. I can faintly smell their scent in here. Plus which, vampires don't have last names, Mr. Lowell. I gave up Reynolds when I changed, at least for the foreseeable future. You know how you've had to deal with money issues because you live so long? Well, compound that by 10. Michael set up a group in this bank and a couple of ancillaries to handle the situation without having to create new personas every 30 years or so. If Mr. Berger isn't a part of the in-group, I imagine my name will be flagged and we'll get a different contact.
How will you know if he knows anything?
Why, Mr. Lowell, I'll see him sweat.
Graham Berger was having a fine day. He had just gotten off the phone with a small business that had decided to move their accounts to his bank. While not something that would get him a raise, with enough of these little victories, he would be on track to receive a great quarterly review. His message waiting light was on.
Yes, you have a message for me?
Mr. Berger, you have an impatient American waiting for you in the lobby. Name's Bethany Anne.
All right, Lydia. Thank you.
Not even an impatient American would ruin the triumph he felt right now. He ran the name through the system to see if anything was pending for her. Not only was something pending, but there was also a flag next to her name. Here was a way to ruin his feel-good moment. He opened the necessary files and reviewed them. This lady was to have access to 8 accounts. There was enough money in these accounts to float a small to medium-sized nation. Not only was she knocked, but she had to be high up to access this kind of money. He literally couldn't afford to upset her, or his quarterly review would be unnecessary. He'd either be out of a job or dead. Graham was on the inside, as it was called in the bank, but this was his first meeting with a real knocked. Since he worked days only, he had never considered he would be called on to interact with any of them. He quickly grabbed all the paperwork he'd need, stuffed it into folders, and closed and locked his computer. There was only one way knocked were allowed to confirm their uniqueness. He really hoped she wasn't hungry. Putting on his coat and hopefully hiding the perspiration under his arms, he went out to meet his newest client. Unfortunately, the receptionist had it all wrong. Everything he knew about the Nacht suggested to him this lady was being incredibly patient. He tried not to jog out onto the floor. Nathan kept an eye on the bank, but mostly watched the large television that had CNN running, when a younger man, probably mid-30s, in a 3-piece dark blue suit with red pinstripes, headed in their direction. He was sweating, and his eyes kept shifting to Bethany Anne and away again. Nathan watched as the receptionist clocked the director's stress and slid her hand under her desk. The guy saw this and surreptitiously shook his head, and the receptionist removed her hand. Beside him, Bethany Anne stood up. If he could get past the vampire thing, she was an incredibly beautiful woman. Her gracefulness led one to believe she must have been a ballerina. Her looks even caused the bank representative to do a double take. It was obvious the person he'd expected to meet and the person he actually was meeting didn't match up.
Miss Bethany Anne? I'm Graham Berger, your representative, and I can help complete your accounts, setup, so you may access the funds. Would you walk with me?
Bethany Anne took his hand graciously and shook it.
Certainly, Mr. Berger. Please lead on. My compatriot, Mr. Lowell, will be joining us.
She didn't ask for Mr. Berger's permission for Nathan to come, but he wasn't about to refuse this woman anything. He led the way across the foyer and went to a wood-paneled wall. He pushed a small catch, which was hard to see, that opened a door. Then he stood aside. Nathan went in first, followed by Bethany Anne, who smiled sweetly at Berger.
Oh.
He closed the door behind them. Inside was a short hallway with a coffee bar, refrigerator, and snacks all laid out on the left. And on the right, in a room about 12 by 15 feet, was a couch on the near wall with a gorgeous rug and coffee table. Toward the other end was a table with three chairs around it. When the door shut behind them, you could feel the pressure.
Would either of you care for refreshments?
He hoped he wasn't merely supposed to offer his neck.
No, we're both good, Mr. Berger.
Very good, Ms. Bethany Anne. Would you care to join me at the table? This is a soundproof room. There are no electronic recording devices allowed. I have the bank's full confidence. Since the Nacht set up the requirements for verification, nothing is allowed to be recorded.
Bethany Anne looked at Nathan. He took out a small box from his jacket and retrieved a little rectangular device that he plugged into his phone. In a minute, he shook his head at Bethany Anne.
Very good, Mr. Berger. How would you like me to confirm or verify my identity?
You don't know.
Would you care to enlighten me? Or do I have to play 20 questions? I can guarantee that after the first two, I'll get very annoyed.
Bethany Anne was getting a little worried. Carl had led her to expect that she'd simply have to give some DNA or something. The sweat beaded on Graham's forehead.
My lady, you don't have to prove who you are. Rather, you have to verify that you are, in fact, a vampire?
Did every person think the only thing vampires did was drink blood? She was tempted to see what he would do if she did bring her fangs out.
Mr. Berger, are there specified ways to prove my unnaturalness? I presume you don't want me to bite you, right?
Well, to be honest, it wasn't ever expected that I would have to actually perform one of these introductions. I believe merely showing me your fangs might work?
He sounded so hopeful that she almost did as he asked. But she and Berger would have an ongoing professional relationship, and she wanted him to have complete certainty as to who she was.
How about we do this, Mr. Berger? I can just slap your head off your shoulders. If I fail, then I'm definitely not a vampire. No, wait, that'd make a pretty big mess.
Graham was nodding idiotically at this point. Just then, Nathan cocked his head and turned it toward the entrance.
Everybody down! Now!
It seemed the bank was being robbed.
Those dick nuggets are messing up my day. I swear to God, if I get any blood on my suit, I will shove their guns up their asses.
She assumed anything she did that might show up on video would be erased before anyone could see it. What was the worst that could happen? Michael would show up to spank her? If only he would show up so she could give him a piece of her mind. She took off her pumps and set them on the table, walked toward the door, and disappeared.
Oh.
Graham's mouth dropped open, and he looked at Nathan, who was still staring toward the door. It was soundproof, so what was he listening to? Graham started for the door. Nathan put out his arm to stop him.
You need to go back to where you were just standing. She'll be right back, and if she doesn't come through the door, you don't want to be where she might end up. I'm absolutely sure it would ruin your day.
Graham stepped back into his original place. She reappeared, holding two pistols and an AR-15. She handed the rifle and one of the pistols to Nathan and slid one into her waistband.
Remind me to get a shoulder holster, would you, Nathan?
Nathan nodded, checked out the AR-15, and put the safety on both guns before moving to the hallway. He faced it as if he expected that someone might come in.
Sorry about that, Mr. Berger. Your bank was being robbed. I'd really hate to have my day interrupted.
What did you do?
Oh, I just took the guns away from the annoying fucknuts outside who wanted to rob your bank. I don't have time to deal with the cops right now. Can we get moving with this? Does disappearing and reappearing with guns suit you as verification? If not, I could use a little energy.
Then she willed her eyes to start moving into the red realm on purpose. Usually they went red when she was completely vamping out, but she'd had a discussion with Tom, and he'd explained he could manipulate the right nerves to achieve the effect. It succeeded splendidly.
No, translocation works for me. I have the documents and the account numbers right here for you.
He quickly sat down at the table and pulled out the documents and a pen from inside his jacket. He directed her to all the locations where she needed to sign and provided copies for her. Bethany Anne finished all the signatures, took the copies, and slipped the envelope into her coach purse. Nathan raised an eyebrow at Bethany Anne, who turned to Graham.
Mr. Berger, I really don't want to be interrupted right now. Please see what they want. Oh, and I'll need 3 sets of debit cards attached to the accounts. How can we make that happen?
Graham jumped up and slipped by Nathan to crack the door an inch and talk to a person on the other side. He closed the door quickly and came back into the room.
Well, as you said, there was a robbery attempt, and the police are interviewing everyone before they leave the building. Well, I explained that you were a very important client who didn't want to be involved, but they are very confused about what happened outside. One minute the criminals had guns and black masks, and the next they were all on the floor, without their masks or guns. They have them all cuffed, but don't understand what happened. They are asking for our video.
Who did you talk to out there?
A local officer, I think. I'm sure an inspector will be here as soon as he can.
When the inspector arrives, please have him come in here. I'll take care of his questions. I'll need a large hat and veil to get back out of here.
Why wouldn't you just...
Graham moved his hands around as if something exploded.
I would have to request a small token of your affection, Mr. Berger. Say, a few ounces. Are you offering?
No, I apologize for letting my curiosity go like that. It was inexcusable. I will find a hat, my lady.
With that, Graham bowed and went out the door. Nathan moved to stand near the couch, out of the direct line of sight of someone coming in the door.
So that disappearing trick takes a bunch of energy?
Always trying to get information, aren't we, Nathan? But I didn't use much energy for what I did. I just wanted to encourage Mr. Berger here to be a little more circumspect.
Can you take someone with you?
I don't know. If I do, it might take a dramatically larger amount of energy. I could end up on the other side immediately needing a top-up, and the person I took might become my snack. Seems a little risky.
Do you always have to, eat them?
Nathan was thinking back to the clearing where they had first met. Bethany Anne had plucked at least 80 pounds of hungry wolf out of the air as if it were a feather and proceeded to rip its neck open and drink before dropping the lifeless body on the ground in front of him. It made an impression.
You know, Nathan, I really haven't tried just taking a little sip yet. How about we give it a go real quick?
I'm good, thanks.
A few minutes later, Mr. Berger came back in. He handed Bethany Anne a small manila envelope.
My lady, here are the cards that allow you access to the accounts at any cash access point almost anywhere in Europe. The inspector is here and will be coming this way shortly. I've made sure the video will not be available. As someone with responsibility for your accounts, I have the ability to override even the bank's president if necessary. We will give them any video that doesn't directly show what happened. Well, they'll be less than pleased, but then they don't have a bank robbery to solve. I think they came out ahead in this one. And finally, I have someone out purchasing that requested hat and veil right now.
Very good, Mr. Berger. While I wait, would you give me a printout of the accounts? Any annuities, how the income is derived, and how much is in cash? Thank you so much.
Graham bowed his head and left.
What do you want to do with the weapons?
Nathan looked longingly at the AR-15.
Well, we can probably get away with the pistols, but I'm not sure how to deal with the rifle. It isn't like we can take it with us on the train. Then again, I suppose we could get a case to hide it in.
That's not traceable to us, and I'd feel a little better with a couple of weapons. The randomness of this attack concerns me.
Why? You don't think it's random?
Bethany Anne went over to the couch and sat down. Nathan stuck the pistol in his waistband under his coat. Setting the rifle down beside the couch, he joined Bethany Anne.
Yes, I think it was most likely random. To assume every problem is an enemy action targeted at you just leads to crazy. But to not take precautions in case I'm wrong and it is enemy action is also foolish. Just because the EPC told the Brayshove Pact to back down doesn't mean there isn't a suborning team on the council that would...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.